Hey guys, welcome back. So now we have arrived at the premiere of Death Metal, which on the surface is your sequel to Dark Knight's Metal, but like we talked about a couple weeks ago preparing for this event, it's really the accumulation of every crisis that has taken place prior to this point, but rather than this being another crisis, it's instead referred to as the Anti-Crisis, which is pretty clever once we get deeper into it. But first, if you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to catch the spills every week, and don't forget to hit that bell up top so we can squat up in the comments for the first hour. And shout out to Jesse on Twitter, because I'm talking about the bell on top of the comments, just below the video title, because we had a whole discussion about that. And now, just because I brought it up, I feel like YouTube just might put the bell behind the video, because you know how they like to switch it up every now and then. But either way, getting into Death Metal. So now recently, we talked about how crazy this world is, with it taking place after the war between Doom and Justice, which then took us right into Hell Arisen, which then set the stage for Death Metal. And I got a link below if you need a clearer connection to how everything got this way, because when Death Metal begins, we're here. And when it kicks off, we start off with this soldier who's speaking to an unknown figure. And while it appears and they're in some sort of bunker with all sorts of explosions going on outside, he's relieved that the person who showed up came to their aid, with the soldier also mentioning that he told his men that he knew that this person would show up. And once they arrive, he's pretty much just telling them how bad it's gotten out here, which in a sense could be described as the world going to shit. Then after that, that hit the fan, some of it flew into the frying pan, and then it popped up like hot grease. Now that's in the fire, which I'm sure will make a great bedtime story one day. But after this, we then go over to Themyscira, which at this point has been repurposed to be Hell after the events of Hell Arisen, not long after the Batman Who Laughs had teamed up with Perpetua. And with doing so, he had placed Wonder Woman in charge by threatening the safety of her sisters in exchange for her being the warden on this island. And I like that with doing this, that Snyder didn't take the whole mind control route and have Diana just under some influence from the Batman Who Laughs, but rather she's very aware of who she is. But at this point, some of the memories from the past few months in the conclusion of Hell Arisen, they are a bit blurry. But at this point in time, this is fully Diana, the Queen of Hell, and not just some brainwashed version of her. But also working with her, you have Swamp Thing, and man, he looks rough. Like, Swamp Thing out here looking like Daffy Duck with his beak shot off. And it's almost like the Batman Who Laughs was like, who, Swamp Thing? Oh, he made from the green? Oh, word, light that up. Like, all he need now is a cape made of backwood paper. But either way, when he comes here, he tells Diana that she's been brought a new prisoner, who in this case has been guarded by three bats. And just like we talked about prior to this point, there's a huge number of Nightmare Batman who patrol this earth, kind of like your army for the Batman Who Laughs. And with Swamp Thing telling Diana that this prisoner needs three bats to guard him, it makes her very curious to see who exactly it is. But with leaving here to check out this prisoner, prior to Swamp Thing's arrival, Diana had been tearing down the invisible jet and melting it piece by piece, which previously was orders given to her by the Batman Who Laughs. But also with going to see this prisoner, we get to look at the process of this version of Hell, which for the most part was previously your dungeons underneath Themyscira, which most recently we talked about when Grail became the Queen of Themyscira for a short while, not long after she was locked up down here with Ares. But it's down here where the villains are locked up for either their trespasses against the Batman Who Laughs, or the Batman Who Laughs just doesn't have a purpose for them at this moment. But from what we see so far, this prison serves two purposes, because either those who are brought here, they're immediately imprisoned, or if their trespasses are severe enough, they're then thrown into the pit, which we get the explanation of when we see the Joker locked up down here, rocking some bat shades, and referring to Diana as Wonder Warden, which was a pretty clever name. But it's here where Swamp Thing confiscates the glasses, letting the Joker know that items with that symbol are forbidden by everyone except for the Dark Knights. And had anyone else seen him wearing them, that he could have been thrown in the pits. And when we get to this new prisoner, who's been brought here by the three Nightmare Batman, Diana lets them know that their prison is pretty much at capacity. But this hooded figure who they brought here, he wasn't brought here to be a prisoner, but rather be taken straight to the pits. And when Diana asks who exactly this is, she's immediately scoffed at by the dinosaur Nightmare Batman, who, if I may say, has one of the craziest origin stories. Because in his world, Bruce uploaded his consciousness into that huge dinosaur that's in the Batcave moments before the Batcave collapsed on top of him. But along with that, like, he has a bit of a chip on his shoulder, because nobody really takes him seriously or considers him a real Batman, quote unquote, because he gets super defensive when he's called anything less. But as this prisoner is being taken to the pit, which is more specifically the Tartarus pit, this is something that has been under Themyscira, with at one point this being the prison of Tartarus, the first god of hell, who's actually older than the Greek pantheon. And though he had escaped from this prison thanks to the Justice League, it has now been repurposed as a prison within a prison by the Batman Who Laughs. But with Diana being ordered to take this mystery prisoner directly to into the pits. She initially does question who this is, but with doing so, she doesn't necessarily have time to argue for that answer, because immediately after this, she's called to meet with the Batman Who Laughs and his Justice League outside of the Batcastle. But just before putting this prisoner in the pits, she does recognize his voice when he tells her to remember, but she doesn't have time to speak to him right away, because the Batman Who Laughs is pretty much holding a faculty meeting and she gotta go. But with arriving there and Diana being the last one in, the Batman Who Laughs kind of teases her, telling her that I know you're probably tired of me, but at the same time he believes that there's a part of her that enjoys being evil a little bit, which personally in my opinion I'd kind of doubt, because truly your prime Earth Diana, at her core she's really like that blend of Batman and Superman, because on one hand where Superman's like a Boy Scout, Diana also has her Girl Scout qualities, but on the other hand similar to Bruce, she doesn't mind breaking some bones in order to get the job done. But then taking it a step further, worse than Bruce, Diana is a through and through warrior, and if she needs to kill to win the war, unlike Batman or Superman, she won't hesitate. And that's probably the part of Diana that the Batman Who Laughs is referring to. But getting into this meaning of quote, the Batman Who Laughs Justice League, we see Harley Quinn with her giant mutant hyena, to where at this point she's been delegated as the Hunter of the Wastelands. Then we also have Aquaman, who's in charge of the oceans and leader of the Black Fleet. And there's also Batmage, who I'm not sure if he's the same one from Earth 33. We'll probably figure that out as the series continues. But then we also have Mr. Miracle, who is set to be the Guardian of New Apocalypse. But from the looks of it, it seems like they're still working on him complying to the New World Order, which at this time is also the case with Superman, because at this point, one of the Nightmare Batmen, they report to the Batman Who Laughs that they're still working on Superman, submitting to the Anti-Life as shown in this projection. And after that process is complete, he'll then be able to serve his purpose, like we had talked about in the previous video. But also at this point, the Batman Who Laughs comes to tell them that Perpetua has continued her work from the conclusion of Hell Arisen, with destroying more Earths out of the 52, which is also something we'd seen firsthand within the war between Doom and Justice. But at this point in Death Metal, out of the 52 Earths, only 8 remain, with Earth 22 being the most recent to go. But in the middle of the Batman Who Laughs giving this update, Diana is contacted by Earth Zero Bruce, who's able to reach out to her because he had copied the frequency which was once created by the Martian Manhunter, which we had seen in Justice League that the Martian Manhunter created in order to link the entire team. But with contacting Diana here, he lets her know that he's informed that she's been ordered to break down the invisible jet, but he wants her to use the pieces so that they can create an armor to infiltrate Castle Bat, which is where this meeting where Diana is at is taking place outside of. Which also, as you may have guessed it, this is the castle of the Batman Who Laughs, who had built it on top of a graveyard of a number of historical Gotham rebels who had been slain by the British years ago in Gotham's Revolutionary War. But with Bruce reaching out to Diana, he wants to use the pieces of the invisible jet that have been melted down in order to create stealth armor so they can break in and use the technology of the Batman Who Laughs in order to create an undetected world of their own so that the heroes can regroup and combat the Batman Who Laughs and his new empire. But on top of this, Bruce admits that he doesn't remember everything himself, and through this mental link he asks Diana to catch him up with the parts that she does remember, which at this point for her, like I mentioned before, is only pieces and partial images. To where when we see these images, on one hand you have a glimpse of Doomsday Clock, which on the flip side is an exact mirror of Dark Knight's metal, almost as if they're polar opposites with a positive and negative effect. But as we see, this is something that they've got to piece back together and figure out, with not only remembering what happened, but also placing together when all these events took place in their order. And so now clearly, with Diana having this full-blown conversation with Bruce in her mind, the Batman Who Laughs realizes that she's not all the way there. And it's almost as if the Batman within him, who's known a number of Dianas from a number of worlds, he sees the look on her face and immediately he's like, okay, what are you planning? Like, what's the plan? Spill it. But immediately after, out of the trees comes his arrow with a bat missile on the end that is shot directly at the Batman Who Laughs. But of course, his Robins, they take the brunt of the hit. But when this happens, this of course is the arrival of Earth Zero Batman, who's wearing a modified version of the Cloak of Erasure, which he had received from Zatanna. But when he arrives here, the Batman Who Laughs calls in the cavalry of Nightmare Batman from their different patrol locations all to come here and take Bruce out. And though Diana tries to stop as many as she can, along with other members of the Batman Who Laughs Justice League, but they're all held back by the Nightmare Batman who are already at this meeting. But Bruce, he ain't even worried about that, because he has brought with him the Black Lantern Ring, and likely because he knew that Castle Bat was built upon the graveyard of Gotham's rebel ancestors, who many years ago some of them called themselves the Dead Bats, because they would beat drums in the middle of the night to appear like they were greater in numbers and scare off the British. And with Bruce having the Black Lantern Ring, he just raises them from the dead, and he sends them to fight the Nightmare Batman. But with doing this just before Bruce leaves, he tells Diana that this plan that he has, that this is how they must win. Like, they gotta save what they can. But Diana lets him know that the new prisoner that she had seen, that he may have a better answer that can take them beyond just salvaging what they can and bring them back to a world that's almost normal. Which at this point leaves Bruce and Diana with two different opinions on how to resolve this, but nonetheless, from here they're both gonna pursue their personal idea of how to win, if that's even possible. But as Batman leaves, we also see that Jonah Hex, that he's been set as the leader to the Dead Bats to carry on as their commander against the Nightmare Batman. But also from here, for a quick minute, we then jump over to Lobo, who's further out in deep space on the planet Ossix, which is made of living bone. And though we're not told specifically, it's likely that Batman sent him here to retrieve something to help them in this fight, and in addition, possibly even use this planet as a base for the heroes during this time. But with Lobo coming to this planet and digging in this specific spot, like this planet being made of bone, for one, it reminds me very much of the Black Lantern Ring and some of the things that we had learned about it in Blackest Night. Because with the Black Lantern Ring, which eventually takes root within its user, which will likely become a reason to why Batman can't use it indefinitely, but back during Blackest Night, when Ray Palmer took a much closer look into the construction of the ring, when they were trying to combat against it, he had also seen that within a Black Lantern Ring, that there was a bone-like structure that was connected to the unseen skeletal anatomy of the universe. And that specifically is likely what Batman has planned in association to that planet and whatever Lobo's looking for out there. But back in Themyscira, we go back to Wonder Woman, who's made her way to the Tartarus pits so that she can talk to this mystery prisoner. And against her advice, Swamp Thing sticks around, because with her going in, it's likely the Batman who last will see her, because prior to this point, he's demanded that no one speaks to this prisoner. And as it turns out, it's because this prisoner is Wally West, with the freaking Dr. Manhattan symbol on his forehead, which is something we'll learn more about within the 6-part series, Generation Zero, which at this point has been delayed, but even still, Diana has no recollection of those memories as well, aside from harnessing this blue energy that still emits from Wally West within this moment. But for her, her memory is cut from just knowing that piece up to where everything is the way it is now. But with Wally being extremely drained in this moment, Diana tells him to rest, but since she knows that he's been all throughout the multiverse, she then asks him to tell her how do they win this. And as he explains this to her, he lets her know that it's connected with every crisis event ever. And he explains how things like the Speed Force, the entire emotional spectrum, and even the forces of justice, like we've seen in the sixth dimension, but they're all connected and they have their polarity with chaos magic, the anti-life, and the forces of doom. And to categorize this or even simplify it, Wally expresses that the positive instances he just calls connective energy with everything associated with justice, but on the flip side, with everything associated with doom, Wally then calls those crisis energy. But as we've seen, the crisis energy is what Perpetua had built the multiverse off of. She used her power, which was born of the presence or of the source, and started this multiverse with crisis energy. Because initially, she was supposed to create it with connective energy and then die, giving herself to that baby multiverse. But of course, she did the opposite with the intention of her in this multiverse living forever. But as we've seen in Justice League, when she was initially stopped and locked within the source wall, reality was corrected and she was imprisoned. But from her imprisonment all the way up to this point, she's been whispering influences of crisis with the intention of getting things back to the way that she intended them to be, which means that at its core, she's influenced every crisis that's happened up to this point. But after being freed from the source wall, she had completely went full force and pursued once again her actions at reshaping the multiverse back to the way that she intended for it to be exactly. But then this ongoing war between crisis energy and connective energy, it was then met with the arrival from another being from another reality, who this being was single-handedly overflowing with connective energy. And this being, of course, being none other than Dr. Manhattan, who in his case, beginning with what we had seen in Doomsday Clock, he had attempted to use his power to heal the fractures within the multiverse which were caused by former crisis. But fast forward to more recently, this didn't have the full intended effect, which is why the Quintessence gathered this energy and handed it to Diana and the members of the Justice League in order to use it against Perpetua. And with doing this, the Quintessence, their intention was to give the heroes connective energy and as much as possible to combat the crisis energy, which as far as crisis energy, at this point Perpetua has it all. So with giving the heroes the boost of energy which had been given by Dr. Manhattan, this was supposed to give them a fighting chance. But somewhere between the heroes going through that door and getting here to Death Metal, that all didn't work out quite as planned. And in fact, things had went so left that this clash between connective energy and crisis energy actually burnt out the sun, which we'll likely learn more about throughout the issues of Flash Forward and the Generation series. But it's here where Wonder Woman comes with the idea of using that connective energy and essentially causing an anti-crisis, which could theoretically put things back together. But while they're here, they're then interrupted by the Batman who laughs, who lets them know that if they even try this plan, that he'll have all of the heroes killed who are currently being held prisoner on New Apocalypse. which I believe at this point has replaced the sun. But the Batman Who Laughs urges Diana just to play along, play her part, with the promise that he'll give the heroes a world of their own where they can live unbothered. And he pretty much lets her know, like, if she does try to formulate a plan to combat him, that it wouldn't work because he's Batman, for the most part. And he tells her pretty much, like, let me guess, you already got a plan. You're gonna take the invisible jet, break it down, make yourself a little cute sword and shield, and more or less hide behind that decloaker secrecy. And Diana lets him know, like, first of all, he doesn't know her as well as he knows Bruce, because what he said did kind of sound like Bruce's plan. But Diana assures him that her plan is already in motion, and rather than any sword or shield, she's combined pieces of the invisible jet with the lasso of truth in order to create the invisible chainsaw of truth. And rather than just explain her complete plan, she just goes for the guts, which is a pure example of what I said earlier. Because though Diana has a heart which is as kind as Super Mario Sunshine, but on the flip side, she won't hesitate to turn into a Mortal Kombat brutality when the situation calls for it, which in this case appears to be the end of the Batman Who Laughs. But as we know, at his core, he's still Batman. So when this happens, at the time of his death, he's prepared the contingency for what appears to be a preparation for his consciousness to be transferred into another body, which ironically is initiated with a button, which is like the reverse of the comedian from Watchmen. But what this initiates is the contingency of the initiation of the final Bruce Wayne, which if I had to guess, this essentially is the Batman Who Laughs becoming Dr. Manhattan. And I gotta say, like, if this is the case, then it's likely the reason why we had seen the Batman Who Laughs holding the Phantom Stranger, taking both energy and information from the Quintessence, which was intended to only be used for the Justice League, which is not a good look for the heroes. And if this is the case, like, they better get Wally West ready and juice back up along with the final bat armor, because things have escalated rather quickly. But we'll see how that plays out. But the last thing we see is that soldier who the story all began with speaking to Batman, who of course was that mysterious figure who pulls him out of there, letting him know that the fight is starting now. And with doing this, everyone needs to fight together, including this guy who's like gone from the torso down. But real quick, I want to give a shout out to all the patrons and thank all of you guys here for continuing to support the channel. And for anyone who's new here who wants more information on how to become a patron, I got a link down below to where you can head over to patreon.com/dopespill. But that'll do it for this one, guys. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below, because it appears that Death Metal is literally including everything from DC Comics ever, which I feel like overall grounds all this craziness like in a weird way. But let me know your thoughts down below, and we'll do it again in the next one. Alright, later.